Greetings, brothers and sisters in Christ. It is wonderful that we can once again continue to join together, even if it is only online, so that we can worship God, hear His word, and continue to grow in our faith. Friends, last week as we went through a series in Colossians, we learned that Christ is preeminent, that all creation is made for Him, that Christ is the one who sustains all things. And so, friends, let us keep that in mind and come to Him in prayer. Our Heavenly Father, Lord, we give You thanks for Jesus Christ. We thank You that through Him we can come to You in prayer. And Father, we thank You that Christ has come to claim His kingdom, to claim His kingship, and that He is exalted above all things, that He is seated on high with all power and authority. And Father, let us remember that today as we continue to listen to His words. And Father, we pray that You will help us to submit to Him, that You will help us to be loyal subjects to Him. And we pray, Father, that You will help us to do this with joy and thanksgiving. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Friends, our next hymn, "Oh for a Thousand Tongues to Sing," pictures a thousand tongues, a vast multitude, singing praises to Christ. And so, let us join in that song of praise as well. And let us sing together.
Thank you. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, God is faithful and just, and will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us therefore draw near to the throne of our gracious God through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, and confess our sins together. Heavenly Father, you have loved us with an everlasting love, but we have gone our own way and broken your laws. We are sorry for our sins and turn away from them. For the sake of your Son, who died for us, forgive us, cleanse us, and change us. By your Holy Spirit, enable us to live for you and to please you more and more, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. God wills that all should be saved, and in response to his call, we acknowledge our sins. He pardons those who humbly repent and truly believe his gospel. Therefore, we have peace with God through Jesus Christ, to whom be blessing and honour forever. Amen. Hear these words of comfort from Colossians chapter 1. He has delivered us from the domain of darkness and transferred us to the kingdom of his beloved Son, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. And you who were once alienated and hostile in mind, doing evil deeds, he has now reconciled in his body of flesh by his death, in order to present you holy and blameless and above reproach before him, if indeed you continue in the faith, stable and steadfast, not shifting from the hope of the gospel you have heard.
Jesus, your mercy. Hello, children. I'm sure most of you know that today is Mother's Day. So we have a fun, quick quiz about mothers in the Bible. Now, as we're not able to see you, maybe the adults who are with you can see if you got these answers correct. Now, can you guess the famous mothers? If you think your answer should be A, you raise your left arm up. If you think your answer could be B, you raise your right arm up. And if your answer could be C, you could put your hands on your head. Okay? Are you ready? Okay. So who was the great, 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 great grandmother of Jesus? Was it Elizabeth? Was it Hannah? Or was it Ruth? Who do you think it was? Well, if you put your hands on your head and you got Ruth, you got it right. And I'd be really happy to hear that, because that means you were paying attention in kids' church classes for the last couple of weeks. Okay, question number two. Now, this mother was childless for many years, but after much prayer, she became the mother to Samuel the prophet. Now, was that Rachel A? Was it Hannah B? Or was it Eve C? What do you think? Well, if you put up your right arm and answered Hannah, you got it correct. Well done. Okay, so third question. Now, this lady was the mother of Jesus. Was it A, Esther? Was it B, Sarah? Or was it C, Mary? I think that one's quite easy, isn't it? Did you all put your hands on your head and answer Mary? If you did, you got it right. Well done. Now, our last question. This lady was the very first mother. She was the mother of all mankind. Now, do you think it was A, Eve? Could it be B, Rachel? Or could it be C, Esther? Okay, what do you think? Well, if you answered with your left arm, you would have got it right. That's Eve. Well done. Good job to all of you. Well, so each one of those ladies was special. God made them a part of his big plan to save people for his kingdom. Now, whether we're children or adults, God has given each of us a mother. Now, don't say it out loud, but maybe think of an answer in your head. Why is your mum special? I don't know what you think is special about your mum. Maybe she cooks delicious food or washes your dirty clothes, or perhaps she helps you with your homework. Or maybe she's really patient or makes you laugh or takes you to different activities and does things with you at home. Whatever it is that makes her special to you, today is a good day to thank God for her. Well, every day is a good day to thank God for her, right? Now, I think very often mums are really good at caring, but that's no surprise to God, because look what he says in the Bible. The Lord says, as a mother comforts her child. If we're fortunate enough to have a loving mother, then we know that she comforts us, which means she cares for us. That's one of the very special things about mums. They can be wonderfully good carers. When we're sad, it's often our mums who are there to cheer us up. When we're hurt, it's often our mums who are patient with us as we recover. When we're frustrated or down, it's often our mums who encourage us and remind us of our blessings. Some of us have had mums who didn't care for us, and this may be a difficult time to remember them. All of us have had mums who sometimes have found it hard to care for us. Many of us have been fortunate to have other ladies in our lives to care for us, grandmothers or aunties or other ladies, and this is a good time to thank them too. The Bible says that God is like the best mum imaginable. Remember, the Lord says, as a mother comforts her child, so I will comfort you. That's in Isaiah chapter 66, verse 13. The Lord God is there to care perfectly for us. As a mother cares for her child, so God is the one that cares for us. Can you imagine a mum who is always with you, who knows exactly how you're feeling, who is powerful enough to help no matter what the problem, who understands what you're going through, who never loses her patience, who always listens to you, who always has something to say to help? That's what God is like. If we trust Jesus, we know it's true. By his Spirit, he's always with us. As our Creator, he knows exactly how we're feeling. As the Lord of the universe, he is powerful enough to help no matter what the problem. As his Son walked among us, experiencing life like ours, so he understands what we're going through. As the very definition of love, he never loses his patience. As the one who hears every prayer, he always listens to us. As the author of the Bible, in his Spirit's power, he will always have a word to say to help. And most of all, God sent his Son, Jesus Christ, to die to rescue us. He has done everything so we can enjoy his comforting care now and forever. Remember, the Lord says, as a mother comforts her child, so I will comfort you. The reason God does that is because his love for us is unimaginably large. Whatever our experience of our mothers has been, good or bad, there is one who offers the deepest comfort today. Today is the day to say thank you to God for all the ways your mum cares for you, and to thank him that he cares for us even better than any mum can. And if your mum is with you, or a phone call away, say thank you to her today too. Let's pray. Our Father, we praise you for your huge love. Thank you that you invented mothers and gave us each a mum. Please help us to see how much our mums have cared for us and to thank them today if we can. Thank you that mothers help us to understand a little of what your comfort is like. You care for us perfectly, and we thank you that Jesus makes sure we can enjoy knowing you forever. Amen.
Morning, church. This week's Old Testament reading is taken from Proverbs chapter 3, verse 13 to 23. Proverbs chapter 3, verse 13 to 23. Blessed is the one who finds wisdom, and the one who gets understanding. For the gain from her is better than gain from silver, and her profit better than gold. She is more precious than jewels, and nothing you desire can compare with her. Long life is in her right hand, in her left hand are riches and honor. Her ways are ways of pleasantness, and all her paths are peace. She is a tree of life to those who lay hold of her. Those who hold her fast are called blessed. The Lord, by wisdom, founded the earth. By understanding, he established the heavens. By his knowledge, the deeps broke open, and the clouds dropped down the dew. My son, do not lose sight of these. Keep sound wisdom and discretion, and they will be life for your soul, and adornment for your neck. Then you will walk on your way securely, and your foot will not stumble. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Today's reading is from Psalm 30. Joy comes with the morning. I will extol you, O Lord, for you have drawn me up and have not let my foes rejoice over me. O Lord, my God, I cried out to you for help, and you have healed me. O Lord, you have brought up my soul from Sheol. You restored me to life from among those who go down to the pit. Sing praises to the Lord, O you saints, and give thanks to his holy name. For his anger is but for a moment, and his favor is for a lifetime. Weeping may tarry for the night, but joy comes with the morning. As for me, I said in my prosperity, I shall never be moved. By your favor, O Lord, you made my mountain stand strong. You hid your face, I was dismayed. To you, O Lord, I cry, and to the Lord I plead for mercy. What profit is there in my death? If I go down to the pit, will the dust praise you? Will it tell of your faithfulness? Hear, O Lord, and be merciful to me. O Lord, be my helper. You have turned for me my mourning into dancing. You have loosed my sackcloth and clothed me with gladness, that my glory may sing your praise and not be silent. O Lord, my God, I will give thanks to you forever. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and forever shall be. Amen.
The New Testament reading is taken from Paul's letter to the Colossians, chapter 1, verses 24 to the end, and chapter 2, verses 1 to 5. Now I rejoice in my sufferings for your sake, and in my flesh I'm filling up what is lacking in Christ's afflictions, for the sake of his body, that is, the church, of which I became a minister according to the stewardship from God that was given to me for you, to make the word of God fully known, the mystery hidden for ages and generations, but now revealed to his saints. To them God chose to make known how great among the Gentiles are the riches of the glory of this mystery, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. Him we proclaim, warning everyone and teaching everyone with all wisdom, that we may present everyone mature in Christ. For this I toil, struggling with all his energy that he powerfully works within me. Chapter 2. For I want you to know how great a struggle I have for you and for those at Laodicea, and for those who have not seen me face to face, that their hearts may be encouraged, being knit together in love, to reach all the riches of full assurance of understanding and the knowledge of God's mystery, which is Christ, in whom are hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. I say this in order that no one may delude you with plausible arguments. For though I am absent in body, yet I am with you in spirit, rejoicing to see your good order and the firmness of your faith in Christ. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Well, good morning, sisters and brothers, and a very happy Mother's Day to those who are celebrating. Can you turn with me, please, to Colossians chapter 1, verse 24, to chapter 2, verse 5, which is our epistle reading for today. Colossians 1, 24, to chapter 2, verse 5. If you've got that, let me lead us in prayer as we begin. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you that you speak to us by your Spirit through your word. Please speak to us as we look at this passage together. Please encourage us and strengthen us and warn us and protect us. And please help us by your Spirit to respond rightly to you. In Jesus' name, amen. When we're involved in God-glorifying Christian ministry, what should we expect? Should we expect that everything will be smooth sailing? That God will just lead us from one success to the next, that everything will fall in place, that will turn out well, and we have minimal pain. We effortlessly bound from one victory to the next. The gospel goes striving forth into the world. Or do we expect it to sometimes be difficult? Should we expect it to work hard and get tired? Or should we expect to be disappointed, to face hurdles and struggles and suffering? Is ministry meant to be easy or hard? And if it's difficult, is it really worthwhile? Or should we just give up? In our passage today, the Apostle Paul, carried along by the Holy Spirit, describes his ministry. Look at some of the words he uses to describe it. In verse 24, he talks about suffering. In verse 29, he talks about toil. In chapter 2, verse 1, he talks about struggle. And yet, this passage is also marked by something else. We see the word for it both at the beginning of the passage in chapter 1, verse 24, and at the end of the passage in chapter 2, verse 5. And that is the word rejoicing. Suffer, suffering, toil, struggle, and rejoicing. In fact, Paul says in chapter 1, verse 24, that he rejoices in his suffering. Now, a masochist is someone who gets a kick out of suffering pain. And a sadist is someone who gets a kick out of someone else suffering pain. I don't know if you've heard the joke about the sadist and the masochist who were stranded together on a desert island. And the masochist says to the sadist, "Hurt me, hurt me." And the sadist says, "No." Paul is not a masochist. So why does he rejoice in his suffering? Well, he does so because he knows that his suffering is worth something. It's not meaningless. To begin with, he knows who he's suffering for. In verse 24, he says, "I rejoice in my suffering for your sake." At the end of verse 24, it says, "For the sake of his body," that is Christ's body, that is the church. He knows that he suffers for God's people. But more than that, he knows that his suffering is achieving something astounding for them. Look again what he says in verse 24. "I rejoice in my suffering for your sake, and in my flesh I am filling up what is lacking in Christ's afflictions." Now, that's a bit mind-blowing, isn't it? You've got to admit, that's not what you expect him to say. He is filling up what is lacking in the sufferings of Christ? In what sense is Christ's suffering lacking? Was not his sacrifice complete? Did he not bear all our sins in his body on the cross? Did he not rise from the dead to show that sin has been completely dealt with? How can Paul say that he suffers to make up for some deficiency in the afflictions of Christ? How can he finish a finished work? Well, it's important for us to work this out, because by doing so, we will understand why he rejoices in his sufferings for the church. And if we get that, and that'll help us to think about our own situation as well. In order to work out what Paul means, we need to look further at why Paul is suffering for the church. What is it he's doing that is so difficult? Well, he says in verse 25 that he became a minister. The word really there is servant of the church. "According," verse 25, "to the stewardship from God that was given to me for you." In other words, God had given Paul a responsibility. And that responsibility was, verse 25 continues, "to make the word of God fully known." Paul was entrusted to make the word of God known. And this word of God that he proclaimed was, in verse 26, the mystery. Now, what's a mystery? A mystery is a secret, something that couldn't be known unless the person whose secret it is reveals it. Right? For example, "You do not know what is in my hand." Right? That is a mystery to you. "But if I reveal it to you, then you'll know what it is. And it is, ta-da, a paperclip." Now, Paul was meant to proclaim the mystery that, verse 25, was hidden, or verse 26, was hidden for ages and generations, but is now revealed to his saints, that is, the people who belong to Christ. Now, Paul was to make that mystery fully known. That secret that was to be revealed was going to have its rich impact not only among the Jews, but also, in verse 27, among the Gentiles, those non-Jews, those who didn't have the God's Old Testament promises. And so what is this mystery, this glorious secret that's no longer a secret, and Paul is charged to proclaim to everyone? while Paul tells us three times. The end of verse 27, this mystery which is Christ. Verse 28, him, that is Christ, we proclaim. Or in chapter 2, verse 2, you go down to that, it says, the end of verse 2 says, God's mystery which is Christ. In other words, the greatness and glory of Christ, which is seen in the gospel, that is the mystery that Paul gladly suffers in order to proclaim. And he has already spoken about it at length in our passage last week. Christ is the one by whom, through whom, and for whom the whole universe exists. He is the King of creation. Christ is the head of the church, his people. The whole fullness of God is found in him. Through his death on the cross, God has reconciled all things to himself. At the cross, he defeated the devil and all his minions, and he paid the penalty of our sins so we can be presented holy and blameless and above reproach before him on that last day. All this was hidden beforehand, but now it's uncovered, it's revealed, it's proclaimed to the whole world. And this Christ, he is so great, he is so good, he is so glorious that Paul can even rejoice to suffer if that's what it takes to fulfill his task of making him known. And now Paul says, this Christ, the one that he proclaims, dwells in verse 27 in you, right? Or among you. He doesn't elaborate on that, but we know from elsewhere that Christ dwells in his people by his Spirit. Individually, if we have the Spirit, we can rightly say that Christ dwells in us. And together we can say that Christ dwells among us by his Spirit. The Christ that Paul proclaims is in, with, and among his people. And this Christ, verse 27 continues, is the hope of glory. Right? He is the one who secures our eternal life with God. And if he is in us by his Spirit, then we can be sure of that glorious future. And so Paul and Timothy tell everyone, Jew and Gentile, about Christ, so that they too can share in this glory with him. Him we proclaim, Paul says in verse 28. Christ, not anything else, is the content of their message. It's all about him. And as they proclaim him, as verse 28 says, they warn everyone. They do not shrink from telling people about the danger of not submitting to Christ. And in verse 28, they teach everyone with all wisdom, because real wisdom is founded in Christ and his gospel. That is what they teach. And the purpose of this, at the end of verse 28, is that they may present everyone mature in Christ. That is their goal. They want to see people not only coming to believe in Christ, but growing to maturity in Christ. And maturity is not moving away from Christ to something else, but it's appreciating more and more of the riches that we have in the gospel of Christ and applying more and more the implications of the gospel in our own lives so that we become more and more like him. And so proclaiming Christ, warning people to turn to Christ and remain in Christ, teaching Christ and his gospel, and in doing so, seeking to present everyone mature in Christ. That is Paul's task. That is the responsibility that he's entrusted with. And he says in verse 29, for this I toil. For this I toil. Some people wear themselves out chasing fame and fortune for themselves. That is vain. It will not last. But Paul slogs to proclaim Christ and to present everyone mature in him. And as he does that, he's aware he does not struggle on his own. Verse 29 again. He struggles with all Christ's energy that he powerfully works within him. All right, back in chapter 1, verse 11, he had prayed that the Colossians would be strengthened with power for endurance and patience with joy. And now we see this is his own experience as well. It is God's power that enables Paul to press on, proclaiming Christ, rejoicing in the midst of hardship and suffering. And sisters and brothers, you and I may do a different ministry than the Apostle Paul, but the end goal is the same. We want to see people growing to maturity in Christ. Him we proclaim. Friends, there are many potential messages a church could be proclaiming. There are many religious ideas around, even in Christian circles. There are many different emphases that we could choose to concentrate on. Some people have Christ, but what they really proclaim is health and wealth. Some people have Christ, but what they really proclaim is a denomination or a movement. Some people have Christ, but what they really proclaim is their views on politics. Some people have Christ, but what they really emphasize is something else. Maybe something that's right, but shouldn't be central. Some people have Christ, but what they proclaim is themselves or the personality of their pastors. But sisters and brothers, we must proclaim Christ. Our gospel message must make clear that Jesus Christ is supreme Lord of heaven and earth, that he died for our sins in our place, that he rose from the dead, that he will come back to judge the world and save his people. Him we proclaim. That's our emphasis. And no matter what kind of ministry we are doing, no matter what part we play in seeing Christ proclaimed, we know that it's not always going to be easy. It's not always going to be sunshine and fun. Sometimes it will be hard work. Sometimes there will be suffering and pain. But even in the midst of that, there is a joy in knowing that what we are doing really is worthwhile. There is a joy in knowing that directly or indirectly, we are seeing Christ proclaimed. And he deserves to be known. There is a joy in seeing people come to share in the hope of glory. And one day there will be a great joy in seeing the people that we have helped, directly or indirectly, being presented mature in Christ. So let us pray that God will strengthen us in the midst of the difficulties of ministry with power to persevere with joy. Now, Paul struggles and toils for the spread of the gospel to everyone. But he tells in chapter 2, verse 1, that it's a particularly great struggle for the people in Colossae and for those at Laodicea and for all who have not seen him face to face. And he is struggling so that their hearts, verse 2, may be encouraged. Their hearts may be encouraged, having been knit together in love, or you could translate that having been instructed by love, perhaps even through this letter. And he wants their hearts to be encouraged in order, verse 2, to reach all the riches of full assurance of understanding and knowledge of God's mystery. All right, put it simply, he's struggling so that they would be assured that they really do know God's mystery, that they'll be assured that they really do know God. He's working hard so they'll be confident that because they have Christ, they really have insight into the mind of the Creator himself, that the mystery of God is no longer mysterious to them, because God's mystery is, as we've seen before and we see again, is Christ. In whom, verse 3, in whom are hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. Right, Paul labors so they'll be secure in knowing that all they need to know about God has been revealed to them in Christ. That all the wisdom, all the knowledge, everything they need for life and godliness is found in him. And why does he want them to know this? Well, because there are some people who are trying to rob the Colossians of their assurance. They are trying in verse 4 to delude them with plausible arguments. So far, the Colossians haven't fallen for this, and so Paul is thankful. He says in verse 5, though I'm absent in body, yet I'm with you in spirit, rejoicing to see your good order and the firmness of your faith in Christ. And friends, as I look around, I think we can say the same thing for us. As a church, there are many ways that we can improve. We all know that. But I am thankful that on the biggest and most important thing, this thing, we can rejoice. that by God's grace we stand firm in Christ and his gospel. Let us never be swayed from that. And let us never take that for granted. Like the Colossians, we too must be alert for the dangers. For people will come to us and say, yes, Christ is so important. We really respect the insights that he gives you into God and his nature. But you know, there are other insights into God that you can get from this other thing as well. God has scattered his revelation in different religions and different systems. You need to broaden your horizon to get a more comprehensive view. You mustn't just be like those blindfolded men who hold on to the elephant's tail and think that's the elephant. No, no, no. Learn from the religion that's holding the elephant's legs, this creed that's holding the elephant's trunk, and this philosophy that's holding the tusks. And then, like us pluralists, you'll get a picture of the whole. Do not be deluded by plausible arguments, the Bible says. The Bible says that in Christ are hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. Do not look outside of Christ for the knowledge of God. Be assured that in him we really do have all that we need for salvation and godly living. We will spend the rest of our lives mining these treasures of wisdom and knowledge that are found in Christ. We will continue to grow in understanding and appreciating and appropriating these treasures. But we will not, we need not, and indeed we cannot go anywhere else to find them. They are all in Christ. So now we've seen in this passage why Paul is suffering. He's suffering to bring the gospel to the Gentiles who didn't know about Jesus. He's suffering to build the Christians up to maturity in Christ. And he's struggling to help the believers keep the assurance that Christ is all that they need. That's why he toils. That's why he works so hard. That's why he suffers. But remember how we were puzzled how he described it at the beginning of the passage. Filling up what is lacking in Christ's afflictions. How does this help us understand that? Well, think about it this way. Let's say that the Reverend Gordon Kong decides to give you the gift of a new car. Right, Gordon goes to the car dealer, he chooses a car for you, he pays for it out of his hard-earned money, and he says to the car dealer, I want you to deliver it to so-and-so, that's you. And so the car dealer drives the car, and he takes it to you. And he says, here's a gift from Gordon Kong, here are the keys, it's yours. Now, who bought you the car? It's Gordon, wasn't it? But you know, if Gordon had simply paid for the car and walked away, you would never have got it. Because the car would still be in the dealer's showroom. Paying for the car was not sufficient. Someone had to deliver the car to you. And unless someone did that, then you would not enjoy your new car. And friends, Jesus paid the price for our salvation. He died on the cross for all our sins. He took all our blame, our punishment for us. He suffered for us. And that was sufficient to take away all our sins. Nothing lacking in that. But for us to enjoy the benefits of that salvation, more suffering was needed. Someone needed to get that message out to us. Somehow or other, the fact that Christ died for us and rose again needed to be communicated. And someone, or in fact, many people, made significant sacrifices to enable that to happen. Paul did that. People did that for us. But not only that, we need to grow in Christ. We need to learn more and more about him from the whole Bible. We need to understand him better and love him more. We need to be warned. We need to be taught. We need to be encouraged so that we might be presented mature in Christ. And that takes time. That takes effort. Paul did that for people. Number of people do that for us. Furthermore, when we are growing in Christ, there will be some people who will try to deceive us into losing our hold on that, who will seek to lead us away from Christ to something else and to rob us of our assurance. And so we need to have people who will stand against that, who will be willing to suffer to oppose those who try to lead God's people astray. Paul did that for people. Number of people do that for us. Paul says he rejoices to do that. It might be hard work, might be toil, might involve suffering. For Paul, it involved going to prison. But it's a privilege to share in the sufferings of Christ. It's not a bed of roses, but it's a joy to make Christ known. I know that there are many people in our congregations who work hard for Christ. You know who you are. You serve tirelessly in many different ways so the gospel can go out. You work with people that can be demanding, or you work to set up processes so that people work and go on unhindered. You create the infrastructure and staff that can be strenuous as well. And yet you serve joyfully from the heart, because you know that every treasure of God's wisdom and knowledge is found in Christ, and the message of Christ simply must go out. My sister, my brother, if that is you, rejoice. For like Paul, your suffering is not an insignificant thing. You are suffering with Christ, like Christ, partnering with Christ, co-worker with him in the work of salvation. And that's a pretty special thing indeed. So next time you're tempted to be discouraged when it's hard, next time you think, is this really meaningful? Next time you wonder if working for the gospel is really worth the effort, then remember that you are suffering with Christ, filling up what is lacking in his afflictions. You are part of his great plan. You are achieving something astounding. We can rejoice that we have the privilege of sharing with Christ the job of saving the world. We are finishing his finished work, and nothing could be more significant than that. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you have revealed yourself perfectly in Christ your Son. Please help us as your people to hold firm to our faith in him. Please help us as we seek to faithfully proclaim him and present everyone mature in him. I thank you for your energy so powerfully at work among us to enable us to persevere with joy, despite whatever difficulties we might be facing. And we pray that you would encourage us and sustain us to keep loving and serving the Lord Jesus all our days. And we pray this in his name. Amen.
Mystery in the dawning. brothers and sisters in Christ, we know that being a Christian is more than right doctrine and understanding, but it is certainly nothing less. Paul reminds us that there are certain beliefs that we profess together as God's people. These include that Christ is the image of the invisible God, and that all the fullness of the Godhead was pleased to dwell in him, and that he made reconciliation through the blood of his cross. Therefore, along with Paul and along with Christians throughout every generation, we profess fundamental truths together of our faith, and we shall do so now in the words of the Apostles' Creed. Let us confess our faith together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Let us pray. Father, we thank you that you have made your word fully known to us through your servant. We thank you, Lord, that you have shown us your glorious mystery, which is Christ in us, that we may all be mature in him. And even as we know you more, Lord, help us, please knit us together in love, that we may serve and truly love each other. Father, we pray that this may be true of all who follow you, who call on your name. We pray for the church in Malaysia, for her leaders, as well as her congregation, O Lord, that we all may be a salt and light in these dark times, that your glory and your love may be known to the world around us and felt by them as well. We also ask, O Lord, for your mercy for the nations in the world that are most affected by this virus, economically as well as health and welfare-wise. We pray for their leaders, O Lord, that they will administrate well to the best interests of their people. We pray, O Lord, that you will sustain their frontliners and their infrastructure. But above all, Lord, we pray that the hope of your gospel will penetrate their hopeless situations, and that you may bring your life into the places that needs it the most. Bearing that in mind, Lord, we also want to commit to you those among us who are suffering most from this current situation. Help us, O Lord, as we seek to think about how to rebuild our lives or whether it's even possible. We pray for those who are affected mentally, financially, relationally, or even physically, O Lord. Help us, O Lord, to remember that all these challenges, as real as they may seem now, are only fleeting. Help us, O Lord, to remember that none of these, as big as they may seem, can ever take away what truly matters to us, which is the life that we have in you. We thank you, Lord, that nothing in all creation could ever separate us from your love. We thank you, Lord, for from you, through you, and to you are all things. And may you be glorified forever. In the name of your Son, we pray. Amen.
Please spend a few quiet moments now praying for those people known to you, and for things that may have happened over the past few days since the recording of these online prayers.
Sisters, brothers, good morning. The Lord be with you. And we continue with our prayers in the words of the collect for the day, this fifth Sunday of Easter. Almighty God, who through your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, have overcome death and opened to us the gate of everlasting life, grant that as by your grace going before us, you put into our minds good desires, so that by your continual help, we may bring them to good effect. Through Jesus Christ, our risen Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And today, we also continue with the words of the Collect for Mothering Sunday. God of compassion, whose Son Jesus Christ, the child of Mary, shed the life of a home in Nazareth and on the cross drew the whole human family to himself, strengthen us in our daily living, that in joy and in sorrow, we may know the power of your presence to bind together and to heal, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Our third collect for the day, for the spread of the gospel. We praise you, Lord of all, for the glorious hope you have given us in Christ. Hear our prayer for all who do not know your love and have not heard the gospel of our Savior. Send out your light and truth through the messengers of your word and hasten the coming of your kingdom through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And we pray now in the words that our Lord Jesus Christ taught us himself. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Good morning once again, sisters and brothers. A few announcements for you. First of all, can I remind you again to subscribe to our email mailing list for all the latest information and announcements from the Cathedral. You can do that from our website. Can I also remind you that you can still register for our online small groups, our online Tuesday night training, our online marriage seminar, and the online adult baptism and confirmation courses. All that also you can do from our website. Details of how you can give to St. Mary's are also on our website. And we do thank God for the way, for those who have responded one way or another to our financial situation. And we're so privileged to partner together in proclaiming Christ. Let me tell you now about another way that we can proclaim the gospel together. Life Explored is an informal and relaxed 7-week series for anyone who wants to explore the meaning of life and discover true contentment. It uses a combination of video and Bible passages to help us do that. And it's designed so that people who don't know anything about the Bible beforehand are able to come. And people can ask questions if they like, or they can just sit quietly and listen. We're going to be running it online on Sunday afternoons from the 31st of May, and it's completely free. People will need to register before the cutoff date. You can't just turn up on the day. And so can I encourage you to start prayerfully inviting your friends to come along for this course and be willing to join with them in doing so if they're willing to come. And if you get an email or WhatsApp message about the course, then please do pray for God to give you wisdom about who you can forward it to, and then send it to them with your own personal invitation. More details about the course are on our website. We've seen today how Paul was willing to struggle and toil because he was convinced that Christ is all that we need to truly know God. And in our final hymn, we encourage ourselves and each other to tell others about this God who has revealed himself to us in Christ.
Well, that brings us nearly to the end of our online service today. Thank you so much for joining us wherever you are. I do hope our time together has been encouraging and edifying for you. Let's continue to be thinking of how we can be encouraging our family, our friends, our neighbours at this particularly difficult time, but this wonderful time of opportunity to be sharing the love of Christ with others in whatever we can, whatever way we can, that we might be pointing others to the hope that is ever found in Him. And on that note, let's end our time together by saying the words of the grace to one another. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen. Go in peace to love and to serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.